My name is Tom Weidman. If I haven't had a chance to meet all of you, and I can't tell you how delighted we are to have you all here and have this wonderful panel here today. As you know, the Motor Racing Research Center here in Watkins Glen is the archive, and we struggle to be and strive to be the international archive for the history of motorsports, not just in Watkins Glen, but from all over the country and indeed all over the world. In order to do that, this is my public broadcasting moment. In order to do that, we rely on a number of fundraising activities during the course of the year. As you all know, we make these events free, and for the first time, we are live streaming this to make it possible for anyone in the world to be able to watch and listen in to this fantastic presentation today. We do that, and we're able to offer these things free for a number of fundraisers. I hope many of you had the opportunity to join us for the Kendall and Butch Leitzinger Award Dinner in June, where we honored Roger Penske. If you weren't able to be there, find someone in the crowd who was and have them tell you about it. It was a fantastic event. We also have a wonderful car raffle, and we'd be happy, very happy. I can't tell you how happy we'd be to sell you a raffle ticket when you go back over to the center. And our third fundraiser, and the fundraiser that supports most of our activities, is our membership campaign, our sponsorship team. We have a wonderful spokesperson and letter writer this year in the form of a gentleman named Butch Leitzinger, who's our chairman for this year's sponsorship team. Thank you, Butch. Those letters went out early in the year. We're sending a second mailing out very soon. And if you have not yet had an opportunity to become a member and sponsor, I bring you good news. It's not too late. We'd be happy to help you take on a sponsorship when you go back over to the center after the talk today. So we're going to be talking about Trans Am, and Trans Am started a long time ago, and in fact it started so long ago that there weren't these things. And so I'd like to suggest that this would be an excellent opportunity for you to silence your cell phones or other electronic devices so that they don't interfere with our live streaming and our presentation today. One more item before I introduce our moderator, and that is to acknowledge a young man who has put heart and soul and countless hours into pulling all of this together. Our staff member, Josh Ashby, who's kneeling down here, I think that's really fantastic. I'm going to thank Josh for all of his efforts in pulling all of this together. And now I'd like to introduce another very special person to the International Motor Racing Research Center, Judy Stropus. Judy, for many years, was the timer scorer for the Bud Moore Racing, also for the AMC Javelin team and the Penske Racing Trans Am. She also was the public relations manager for Chevrolet. And it is my pleasure now to introduce and turn this microphone over to Judy.
Certainly people from the past and present who will help decipher all the secrets and all the maneuverings that went on back in the day and probably still go on. But before we go on, I'd like to have everyone see the excellent film that the current Trans Am series management put together that gives you an idea of what's gone on in these past 50 years in Trans Am competition.
On March 25, 1966, 44 cars took to the track at Sebring International Raceway, commencing what was then entitled the Trans-American Sedan Championship. Together, they set into motion 50 years of road racing excellence, a movement that would change the face of road racing forever. From its beginning, Trans Am has been America's road racing series. From the production Pony Wars to the GT factory years to the road racing renaissance of today, the Trans Am series has captured the public's imagination, and the name itself, Trans Am, is known worldwide. 2016 marks the 50th anniversary of Trans Am, and over its five decades of racing, the series has made an unquestionable impact on motorsports, our memories, and our lives through legendary races, legendary drivers, and legendary institutions, all making their mark on the Trans Am. The Trans Am story began modestly enough, the brainchild of SCCA employee John Bishop, as a means to entice America's automotive manufacturers into the realm of road racing.
All the American manufacturers began to put out the sport sedan type car. Then, of course, it was just a natural to give them a good place to race.
Envisioning the potent mixture of pro racers and American performance machines, the timing proved impeccable. With the Trans Am series operating as a true manufacturer's championship and Detroit's new pony cars rolling off the assembly line and into garages as fast as they were produced, the best place to publicize a high-performance car became
the Trans Am Challenge.
A series happy to supply Detroit with the venue to test, develop, and market a generation of automobiles that would come to define the American car and Motor City for years to come. Soon came the iconic phrase, win on Sunday, sell on Monday. Trans Am became the medium to develop brand awareness and loyalty amongst fans as huge dollar commitments from Ford, GM, Chrysler and others created manufacturer and driver rivalries that ultimately resulted in the commencement of the Pony Wars. In the 1960s, Roger Penske's Sunoco Blue Camaros and Mark Donohue quickly established themselves as a force, with Donohue winning 10 of 13 races in the 1968 season. And despite only racing in Trans Am for 4 years, Donohue quickly racked up a then-record 29 victories. Over the next few years, the Penske Camaros and ensuing AMC Javelins would be faced by the Budmore Ford Mustangs of Parnelli Jones and George Fulmer, creating a motorsports rivalry unlike anything America had ever seen.
First Donohue, then Fulmer. Then Fulmer, then Donohue. The lead changes 7 times in the first 50 miles.
1973 saw the Trans Am rulebook evolve. And foreign sports cars such as the Porsches, BMWs, and Datsuns began to make their own impact on the road courses of North America. Then in the later 70s, the big block Corvettes began to separate themselves from the competition in Group 2. While Bob Tullius and the Group 44 Jaguar took a Group 1 championship. The 1980s brought the tube frame, silhouette cars, and a new dynasty to the Trans Am series. Jack Roush entered Trans Am in 1984 and proceeded to absolutely dominate the remainder of the decade, with the Roush team winning 46 of 83 races and posting 97 top three finishes. Roush's Capris and McCours were nay unstoppable in the hands of Wally Dallenbach Jr., Scott Pruitt, and Willie T. Ribbs. Trans Am returned to its roots in 1989 as Ford, Oldsmobile, and Chevrolet squared off. And while the Mustang won the series to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the model, the following years were dominated by Chevrolet, thanks to the efforts of Scott Sharp and Jack Baldwin. Incidentally, Jack Baldwin's Hot Wheels car remains the highest-selling Hot Wheels toy car in history. And while the mid-1990s saw 5 different drivers win the first 5 races of 96, the decade will always be remembered as the decade of Tommy Kendall. With Kendall capturing 4 series championships and winning 11 races in a row in 1997.
He's got running room. Boris is going to take him to the wall.
The new millennium ushered in a new era of Trans Am.
Blocks into the corner, there's contact.
Oh, there's Bell.
Gentilozzi and Bell, they're 3 wide.
With Jaguar and Rocket Sports dominating 3 of 4 seasons, with Paul Gentilozzi overtaking Mark Donohue's overall win record with 30.
Who wants it more?
Oh, they're going for it.
Bell to the inside for the lead. Justin Bell leans on Morris and takes over. And Gentilozzi has an opening. Gentilozzi takes the lead. They've swapped it 3 times. Bell gets turned around. Boris gets by and Bell gets booted out of second spot. Gentilozzi out of the final corner will come to the checkered flag.
Followed by Tony Ave turning in monster performances and capturing the 2010 and 2011 series championships. Trans Am has made huge strides in 4 short years, and the Trans Am series has seen a resurgence unlike any other in motorsports. Now featuring robust fields and entries of 60 plus cars on a regular basis, Trans Am has begun forging a new legacy. Champions such as Ernie Francis Jr., Cameron Lawrence, Doug Peterson, Gar Robinson and Amy Ruman, and have paved the way for a new generation of Trans Am drivers. Alongside Trans Am's new champions, fans will find the traditional Trans Am Grand Touring racer, joined by the modern-day pony wars with the Ford Mustang, Chevrolet Camaro, and Dodge Challenger, once more battling for dominance in TA2 on a massive scale, while the series remains true to its production heritage with the introduction of TA3, TA4, and TA5. Now, as drivers battle for the 50th anniversary championship trophies, the series makes its long-awaited return to Detroit. Trans Am's future is now as bright as at any point in the series' storied history. After 50 years, the Trans Am is still vital, innovative, and true to the spirit of American road racing. Once more, American iron and the thunder of Trans Am engines can be seen and heard across the nation with fields of Camaros, Mustangs, Challengers, Vipers, and Corvettes, showcasing the spirit of our road racing on legendary tracks. From the legends of Dahlenbach, Donahue, Fulmer, Jones, Kendall, Penske, Pruitt, Roush, and so many more, to the modern motorsports heroes of Andretti, Ave, Francis, Peterson, Lawrence, Robinson, Ruman, and others.
Lee Dykstra. Lee also attended the General Motors Institute and worked for Cadillac. He joined Carcraft as a race engineer from 1968 to 70, working on the Ford GT Mark IV and the Trans Am program, where he was responsible for the handling package for the Ford ESV safety car. He was also responsible for the design and development of the 1968 to 70 Trans Am Mustang, which won the championship in 70. Since that time, he started Decon Engineering, designing the IMSA title-winning Chevy Monza in 76 and 77, designing 19 complete race cars for a number of series as president of Special Chassis Inc. and director of technology for Champ Car World Series. He was race engineer for many years after that for a number of open wheel series. John Woody Woodard. Woody worked for Penske Racing for more than 30 years, beginning in 69. In the first 8 years, he was a full-time race mechanic. In particular, he was the chief mechanic on Mark Donohue's 1969 Trans Am Championship-winning Camaro and the 1970 Javelin. He was also chief mechanic on Penske Racing's Sunoco Ferrari 512, the Lola T192, the L&M Porsche 91710, the Porsche 91730, and worked on the NASCAR team fielding the AMC Matador and Mercury Montego. Who remembers those days? continued to work for Penske Racing and other businesses and was a weekend warrior through 89 on the IndyCar team. He retired from Penske Corp in 1999. Don Cox. Don was Penske Racing's first and only engineer from 1969-76. He started his career as an engineer in Chevrolet's R&D department in 1964. He graduated from what he said was Kettering University, but that was originally the General Motors Institute. In 1962, and worked for Chevrolet on the Chaparral project from 66 to 68, before being assigned to Penske Racing's Trans Am project in 69. He left GM at the end of 69 to work Penske Racing's Trans Am Javelin program. Through 76, he was involved in all of Penske Racing's projects, including Trans Am, IndyCar, Le Mans, Can-Am. He also ended up doing business with Penske and ventured into the Detroit diesel business in 76. He retired in 2001 and now spends his free time driving PCA events in the Northeast, including one in Slack. Tommy Kendall. Tommy began his career in IMSA GT, driving a GT Mazda RX-7 and winning the 86 and 87 championships. Later, he won three other titles in the same car, which he still owns. Is that correct?
Other people won three titles in that car. Jack.
Oh, okay. I didn't think this was that. He dominated the SCCA Trans Am Series in the 90s, scoring four championships, racing a Chevy Beretta and a Ford Mustang to those titles. In 97, in a Mustang, he won every single race on the schedule except for the last two, and then represented the series for six IROC seasons. He's competed in NASCAR, in the Bathurst 1000, and in IMSA GTP. In 1991, you might remember, he suffered serious leg injuries at Watkins Glen when a mechanical failure caused his Intrepid GTP Chevy to leave the track and crash head-on into a car wall. NASCAR driver J.D. McDuffie had been killed in the same turn a month later. Both crashes led to the addition of the chicane on the back stretch. He called it a crossroads in his career. He did, however, return racing in 92 and later competed in the Dodge Viper in ALMS. Now he has a broadcasting career, hosting shows on Speed TV in the past and now Fox Sports 1. Butch Leitzinger. Butch finished second in the 2002 Trans Am Series and ended up as the Rookie of the Year, and it was his only season driving in the Trans Am Series, racing the Corvette for Tom Bloy. His career includes racing for the Bentley factory team at Le Mans and the Cadillac team at Le Mans and Panos at Le Mans. He earned victories in the 2010 12 Hours of Sebring Long Beach and a podium finish at Laguna Seca, competing in only four races that year. He's driven in the ALMS series for a number of teams, and he's competed in NASCAR races as a road course ringer, racing three times at Watkins Glen with a best finish of 12th in 95. And of course, he's a son of popular IMSA and Trans Am driver, Bob Leitzinger. So I'd like to start with the elder statesman of the series and of the panel, and that would be Chuck Cantwell. So Chuck, you were originally in the series of 1966 when it started. Tell us how your involvement with Ford and or Shelby.
Okay, yes, I'm in that series. In 65, they decided that SCCA decided to have a series called Trans Am, and Shelby involvement was. We had a meeting with George Merwin and Lou Spencer and myself, and I was assigned the task of doing the homologation papers for the cars for the Trans Am in 66. We hadn't built a car or anything yet, so the car was sort of designed within the homologation papers, and we had to run around, take pictures, accumulate dimensions, and get part numbers for all the options we wanted to put on the car. And that was sent to Ford, and Ford, all they had to do was paste up a made wheel on the side of a picture of a regular Ford sedan, because we didn't have any pictures like that to send them. After the first of the year, Shelby gave me a budget of $5,000 to build a car. And that included going to the dealer and buying a car. So we did that. We built a car and then tested it several times, and then ordered 10 more cars initially. And then altogether, we built 25 cars for customer, Trans Am cars for customers We had homologated Group 1 and Group 2 cars, the Group 2 being the Trans Am car. Group 1 was sort of a modified Mustang that was a rally car. We built four of them to begin with, and they went to Europe and Australia. So we built the cars, and the series was run. First race was at Sebring, and A.J. Foyt ran in that race, ran a Mustang of some kind, not one of ours, because most of the drivers at the beginning were independent drivers that built their own cars, and we sold a Mustang, we sold them parts. But they ran the car, and the first race was won by Jochen Rindt in an Alpha, I believe, and the Mustang was second in that race, or Tullius was second in that part. And then the series went on from there, and ran only seven races in 1966. At the end of the sixth race, Mustang and Chrysler were pretty close in points, and Ford asked us to run a Mustang in the sixth race at Riverside. We had a car that I just tested and had been finished up and was ready for sale. It hadn't been bought yet, so we took that car and freezed it up, took it out to the track with two crew guys and ran the race and won the race. But it wasn't an easy, it was sort of a wire-to-wire win almost. At the beginning, the car wouldn't start and Le Mans start, and so he didn't get off until the middle of the field. And halfway through the race, Terry Titus was driving. He managed to knock the oil filter loose and came in a big cloud of smoke in the pits, and they changed the oil filter and threw in four quarts of oil and hoped that was enough, and he went out and won the race. So that won the championship for Ford and sort of set us up on the line to get a Ford-sponsored team for the 67 season.
So I would then jump over to Lee Dykstra, who got involved in, well, we skipped 1967. I may be the only one who was in the 1967 series on, or you were, in the Trans Am?
I witnessed the one.
Oh, yeah. I know you were, but besides you.
You had a show in 1967.
No, I know, but I mean, other than you.
Okay.
When I was with the Baltimore Cougar team. And that was an interesting, I was introduced to the Cougar team in Marlborough, I can't even say Marlborough, Maryland, for a five-hour race, and I got hired by them, and they paid me $25, but after that, we did a great job, in my opinion, and I was hired for the rest of the season. But let's go to Lee Dykstra, who was very important with the Ford effort, and
Carcraft
at the time. So how did Carcraft get involved in
Trans Am? So Carcraft, can you hear me okay? So Carcraft got involved because Fran Hernandez, who was a Ford liaison for the Baltimore team, got a hold of me because we were doing the Ford long distance cars and essentially a racing engineering shop for Ford, and asked about the rear suspension on the Mustang. Well, it had long upper Lincoln, the thing, which wasn't compatible with the leaf spring geometry. So we told him, this is what you have to do to it. And he must have been impressed or something like that, because the next year, then essentially we got a couple of cars from Shelby, 67 cars, and we built the 68 cars, which you may have seen over at the museum. That was one of the cars that we built. So just prior to the 24-hour Daytona, we built the two cars, and the two cars only were ran by Titus and Butnam and Horace Quick and Alan Moffat. We came in that race, I don't know, fourth overall in the thing. The number second car with Quick and broke a tower in the thing, so it was a DNF. But Jerry's car ran the whole thing, and I can remember coming in pit stops, and we put so much oil in this car that we needed one of the fuel rigs to feed the oil to. And they would open the door and wipe the floor because there was so much oil in the cockpit that his foot was slipping off the pedals, so we had slipping clutch, slipping brakes, and slipping. From then on, there was sort of, I don't know, it was a good thing that we did that first race because we got our spirits up a little bit. But from then on, we got totally beat the whole time because we had an engine that might have been down on power but was unreliable. And then we also were out homologated because the Penske cars had spoilers on the front and rear, and we had nothing. So we spent the whole season, eating whatever crow or whatever you want to call it. And vowed to continue on and do this. So we won, I think, three races in 1968. And all of them were sort of by accident, because we won Daytona, which is fine. The Penske car went out. At Sebring, we lost. We won again with Jerry, actually here at Watkins Glen, and we won at Horse Quack at Riverside. That was about the extent of it. And I've got some stuff a little later. We'll show some pictures of us testing at Riverside, trying to get proper engines. So we had a Gurney Westlake in the car. We had once Shelby guys, John Dunn, built proper tunnel port. We tested that. That was good. And then we had spoilers and all that sort of thing that we tested at Riverside and came back strong in 69 with a proper race car.
So Don Cox, as a GM engineer, as a Chevrolet engineer, at the time, while Ford was openly in racing, Chevrolet was still very much everything out the back door in those days, which made it really very exciting. So tell us about your role in that.
This is where it gets really exciting. Lee and I went to college together. Lee and I built three race cars together after we got out of college. One of those cars was in the Mossport Grand Prix with people like Pedro Rodriguez, Jim Hall, John Surtees, Lothar Motzenbacher, all these kinds of people. And our car qualified seventh. And that's why the Ford guy, Roy Lund, came over. Offered all three of us a job on the spot. Lee and I went over to talk to him the next week. Lee ended up taking the job. I stayed with Chevrolet because I was working on the Chaparral stuff and I was perfectly happy there. So, to try to make a long story short, in June of 68, I ran into Lee on a ferry boat going across to Wisconsin or someplace in Michigan. And Lee was telling me how he was working on the Ford project and they were homologating all of this stuff. And they were gonna beat the guy that had beat him so bad, that was beating him so bad in 68. And I'm yawning and thinking, well, that's fun, that's nice, because I'm working on all this other stuff with the Chaparral and wings and all that stuff, so I was happy. Well, as luck would have it, in March of 69, I get assigned to the Penske project. And I wake up in the morning and I think, oh my God, I'm gonna be involved with the Trans Am cars. These are the same cars that Lee has been working on all of 1968 to go and beat Penske in 1969. And when we got to the first race, those cars were so fast, they beat us four out of the first five races. And the lap times weren't even close. So here's two guys that went to school together, were in business together, that are exact opposites on the two teams. I'm representing Chevrolet and Lee is representing Ford. So that was my initiation into Trans Am racing.
But my question was about the back door, the Chevrolet back door, during those early years of racing?
Well, in the early years of Trans Am racing, I wasn't involved in that. Penske was being helped, as a lot of anybody that wanted to be helped, by the product performance group of Vince Figgins and all these people. And it wasn't until March of 69 that John DeLorean became head of Chevrolet. Roger Penske and John DeLorean were big buddies, and Penske insisted on getting help from the R&D group as opposed to getting help from the product performance group, and so that's how I got involved. But at the end of 69, Penske went to American Motors and hired me away from Chevy. But in 67 and 68, he got technical assistance from Chevrolet, but to my knowledge, never got a penny of actual money. And when American Motors came along in 69 and offered Roger, I think, an order of $1 million to run Javelins, that's when Roger switched from Chevy to American Motors.
Lee, I'm jumping back to Lee because you wanted to talk about how the three amigos, you, Chuck, and well, I should say Ambrose, you, Chuck, and Don got together. The three of you, and you have some slides you want to show?
Yeah, if you want to put them up there. One of the things that Don talked about is us building a car. So I've got some photographs just to show you the car, how it sort of evolved. And I tried to do some pictures that sort of tied in some of the panelists here. So, okay, so this is the car that we built in my garage in Ferndale. So essentially, that's a Buick aluminum-powered C-modified. It had a space frame. It had weighed about 1,300 pounds. Don did the engine transmission and rear Tempest transaxle. The guy driving was Bob Stout, who was another engineer who was in our same class. So he did all the fabrication and welding and that sort of thing. The body came from a place in Minnesota that built. This is sort of looks like a birdcage Maserati, and this particular car learned me a lot of lessons because every time it went off the road, some suspension bent or something like that. We had a swing axle in the back with a totally decoupled, but it wasn't any damping involved. Don ended up crashing this car and totally went down.
Which is the best thing that could have ever happened.
Lee, Mike.
Put the mic closer.
Yes, sir. It crashed at Waterford Hills because there's a carburetor on the thing and it kept cutting out in the turn. And we wouldn't modify the body to put the proper carburetor on it. So it cut out in the turn. And unfortunately, he ended up totaling the car because of it. So the second one, so this is the second car we had. Don and I went to Ford to Jack Passano and got a Ford engine. And the Cadillac guys were so mad that I had a Ford engine in one of these cars that they offered to build me a proper Cadillac racing engine with hydraulic lifters and 300 horsepower and a four-barrel carburetor. So we built a car with a Cadillac engine. This is still a front engine car. And this is the one that raced at Mossport, where we ended up qualifying seventh. The thing obviously looks very nice because it was a male model, male mold for the body, so it never looked much better than that. But it was pretty fast, and the driver was Glenn Lyle, who some of you might know of, that ran Ford Performance for quite a few years. So that's how essentially I got into Trans Am, because I got the job at car crash because of this car.
Right. Well, I think we'll come back to these slides.
Yep.
But I do want to get to Woody, John Woodard, and his early years with Penske Racing. How did you end up getting that job?
In the mid-60s, I was working in Annapolis, Maryland as a mechanic at a sports car shop right in downtown Annapolis. And Marlboro Raceway was less than 20 miles away, and I went to a couple of races and got interested and got my SECA license and invested in a Lotus Super 7 and did a bunch of racing at Marlboro and up and down the East. And in 1967, I happened to attend the Marlboro, I thought it was a 6-hour race, but it could have been a 5 or 3 or whatever. But I'm walking around the infield, and the first day of practice, and this beautiful blue Chevrolet slant-bed truck rolls in with an absolutely gorgeous 67 Camaro Trans Am car on the back. And the mechanics climb out, and they're all dressed neatly in light uniforms. And Mark Donahue gets out of a car, and he's Mr. Nice. And it was just a first-class operation. He gets in the car. He qualified on the pole. They started the race, and Mark lapped the, in spite of Judy's excellent timekeeping with the Bud Moore team, Mark Donahue lapped the entire field two times. Early the next year, I went on up to work for George Alderman in Wilmington, Delaware, and I figured out pretty quickly I couldn't continue racing on a mechanic salary, so I sold the Little Super 7, and I'm fixing rovers and stuff like that for George Alderman. And late in 68, I said, you know, I really like motor racing. I was a pretty decent mechanic. I liked the competition. And I remembered the Penske team that I had seen at Marlborough. And Newtown Square was less than an hour away. I get up one Saturday morning. It's the Saturday before New Year's, of bringing in the New Year of 69. And I go on up the road looking for Newtown Square. And I'm halfway there, and I'm saying to myself, what the hell am I doing? It's a Saturday before New Year's. There's not going to be anybody at Penske Racing. I drive into Newtown Square, find a gas station, ask him where Penske Racing is. He gives me instructions. I go down there. I find the place. The gate's unlocked. There are two cars in the parking lot. I drive up, park, knock on the door, and Mark Donahue opens the door. Invites me in. Introduces me to Roger Penske. I introduced myself, and I said, you know, I'm a mechanic. I work for George Alderman, who Mark knew quite well, and I'd like to work for you. I spent 2 hours. They walked me around the shop asking me a lot of questions of what I've worked on, you know, could I overhaul that Muncie transmission, et cetera, et cetera. And 2 weeks later, Mark called me and said, I want you to start Monday. And that's how I got my job with Penske Racing. My first job was the Bucknum. There were two 69 Trans Am chassis that were there. Both had been had come from the Dipper, and which is a different story. One car had had the roll cage installed, and the chassis had been painted, but there wasn't a single bolt or rivet attached to it. And Mark was off to a test at GM, and then they were going to the 24-hour at Daytona. And he said, hey, there's a shelf of parts for this car. Put together whatever you can. And when they came back after Daytona, the car was complete and ready for an engine. I wound up building both. That first car was the Bucknum car, or the 9 car. And then I built Mark's car. I had been hired as Bucknum's chief mechanic. Mark's chief mechanic was Leroy Guyne, and the first race was at Michigan, which was quite a race. Judy remembers that one. And Mark and Roger and Leroy had a bit of a falling out at the end of the race, and they fired Leroy Guyne, and I became overnight Mark Donahue's crew chief. That's how I got my start.
Chuck, your turn. Talk about your time at Penske Racing. And when you, why you moved over from Shelby to Penske?
Well, I worked for Shelby, started with the GT350 program and went to the Trans Am, 3 years of Trans Am racing. The 68 season, that 67 we won the championship, the 68 or the lead described, we had cars that weren't very reliable, and it was really a rather hectic season, even though we did manage to win 3 races. Mark won all the rest of them in 68. So at the end of that year, I was wondering what I should do, and I knew that Shelby had one more year left in his contract, and he, since all the big international racing with the GT40s and stuff were done at that time for him, I knew he wasn't too interested. He didn't show a lot of interest in what was going on. He came to the Trans Am races, but he went home. This car out here was one that Horse Quick won the race at Riverside, and Shelby went home before the race was halfway over. So I thought, well, the interest wasn't going to be there in a year. There probably wasn't going to be any job because Penske Shelby Racing would all shut down. So Roger had contacted me after the season was over and asked if I wanted to go to work there. And I agreed to do that. So I went to his house and interviewed, talked to him a while, and went to the race shop and looked around and so forth. And it was a pretty easy decision to make, going with a top-class team that had a future to it rather than one that had its future was pretty much gone. So I went to work for them and was very happy to do so.
So we're going to jump a few dozen years, maybe not quite that many, just to the later era, and we'll start with Butch, his 1 year in Trans Am. But your history goes back to being with your dad, Bob, in Trans Am. What did you think about the series at the time as a young person?
Well, I grew up, raised a family, so, like most of us, it's not like today with racing where you have so many different avenues. You can become, if you have the NASCAR fans, there's only NASCAR truck fans. Back then, if it was racing, you were a fan because there was so little to get. You grabbed onto any bit of racing. So, of course, looking at Auto Week and competition news, you would latch onto any information you had. So I followed Trans Am all through the years. My dad raced in Trans Am in 81. He had raced in SCCA Nationals up until then. And the family team had a 300ZX Datsun, 280ZX Datsun that he raced. And it wasn't a terribly competitive car. It was a normally aspirated 3-liter engine up against a lot of pretty heavy equipment. Tom Bloy that year came out with a Ford's return to racing with the Mustang. Bob Talese had the Jaguar. Effie Wheatsitz had a Corvette that was very fast. So for my dad's car, it didn't do terribly well. Like in places like Lime Rock or at Sears Point, where the handling was premier, he would do well. And our, kind of the ending of his Trans Am career was at the end of that year, the rule book came out. And in spite of having a pretty lackluster year, the rules were basically the same for all the cars at the end of the year. But it said specific exception, Datsun 280ZX, normally aspirated, 200-pound weight gain. And there was one 280ZX normally aspirated in the country. So my dad called, I forget his name, the competition director at the time, and said, I read the rule book here. And so, okay. So, did you see what it said? Well, yeah, okay, said this. And my dad said, no. That says, Bob Leitzinger, we don't want your ass in Trans Am. And they said, sorry to hear that. That was kind of his departure from Trans Am. And I guess I'll come back to it, but when I did Trans Am in 2002, when I told him that I was going to be doing it, he kind of rolled his eyes like, oh no. I hope you know what you're getting into. We'll get to that later.
I was going to say, what did you get into? We'll go to Tommy Kendall, the giant killer in the 90s and so. And so you'll have to take his mic. Talk about when you came in, clearly the series had a tremendous history already. When you came in, did you even consider that history? Because you are a bit of a historian, in my opinion. When you started to race and compete against, you were in a Ford and competing against Chevrolet, and then you were also in a Chevrolet in the Beretta competing against Ford. So you've run the gamut.
Well, it's funny, following a little bit of what Butch said, I tell people today, try to remember what it was like. There was no internet, there was three television channels, and there was a handful of magazines that came out once a month. And so if you didn't know someone that did something, you could live your whole childhood and never know it existed. And so when all of a sudden I got exposed to racing, it's like my head exploded. I subscribed to On Track magazine. So from about 81 on, I know everything that happened, because I used to read that cover to cover. Before that, it took me a while until I got more heavily involved to appreciate some of the stuff that went before that. Ironically, one of the first books I read was Paul Van Valkenburg's book, The Unfair Advantage. And I read that long before I ever drove even a go-kart. And then, so the way things worked out, and I was hell-bent to get into open-wheel cars. I wanted to go IndyCar racing. And so budgets and heights conspired a little bit against that. And I ended up spending my whole life in sports cars, and I couldn't have worked out better. And all those years later, to go up against some of those records that were set by some of these guys here, it's funny how that all works out. But so I wasn't, when you're young, you don't have a full appreciation for history, but I had appreciation for what was happening right then. So I started following Trans Am in 81, finally got to driving in 85, 86. I did my first Trans Am race. There was a picture, and it was focused on Pruitt on the victory stand. I was in a Mobil 1 suit to the right. That was my very first Trans Am race. I was racing GTU, and my dad bought that old Gloy Capri that had won the championship in 84. And he said, do you want to run this at Long Beach? And I said, hell yes. And so we didn't know anything about Trans Am cars, so I did all the legwork I could. I tracked down Dave King, who had been at Roush, and got all this. I talked to Willie T, got as much information as I could. We showed up with our little ragtag team in Long Beach and qualified third and finished second behind Pruitt in the Mercure. The water main broke and it flooded the garage, and everybody except Pruitt crashed in the water. I ended up backing out, lost the front end, finished a lap behind Pruitt, but finished in second. And so it was, that's a story that not a lot of people know. A lot of that focus is on the later years. But it's funny, I was fortunate that the 60s, and late 60s, early 70s were the real glory years of Trans Am. But in hindsight, I was honored to kind of be part of the second golden era in the 90s. As my Twitter profile says, I was big in the 90s. And it's funny how fate works out, and couldn't be more honored. The cars are just kind of the perfect, at each step along the way, they were really right for that era. They were quite a bit different through the years, but they were appropriate for what got people excited. And the formula has always been, and that includes today. One of the things I say, very few series now have as much power as they used to. Everybody talks about the glory days of Can-Am, big horsepower. The glory days of IMSA GTP, big horsepower. The only series running today where the most powerful cars ever are running today are Trans Am. Those cars are like almost 900 horsepower now, 800 and some horsepower, and Sprint Cup, and they're about 900 horsepower as well. Everything else is less than their glory days, and it's a little news flash to some of the people running these series. If you want to get people excited, people like the big power. So.
Well, tell me about the Beretta team. That is like an almost forgotten team. It was hard to find anything on Google, and yet I was there. I was part of the Beretta team. And so talk about that adventure with Chevrolet.
Well, I was really indebted, really, to Herb Fischel. He kind of cherry-picked me after I won those two GTU championships in the RX-7. Kind of cherry-picked me. I was going to school at UCLA, and he had this idea that race car drivers were going to become more, it was going to be more about marketing, and they needed to be a little bit articulate and so forth. And so he called me out of the blue and wanted to talk to me about a new program at Chevy, and this was, they were more involved in racing, but it wasn't really totally above board. We're proud that we're in racing. And so things were changing. And in 88, they had a production car called the Beretta GTU. And they had a corresponding race program. And so I did that. We won the championship the first year in the Beretta. And then they said, well, it was supposed to be 2 years. They said, well, let's switch it over to Trans Am. And so that's how the Beretta went into Trans Am. The team was run by Cars and Concepts out of Brighton, Michigan. And the person who designed that car was a guy named Trent Jarman. Lovely guy, but he was employed at Cars and Concepts as an engineer designer. They made sunroofs and convertible tops for automakers. And he designed this car. It was not so hot, and as you would maybe expect. And so we were throwing huge money at this and didn't get any results. I finished second in the championship just by hanging around. Dorsey, the Roush guys pretty much comprehensively destroyed us. Chevrolet hired Doug Feehan, who's still involved in the Corvette program, to kind of assess the program and give his recommendations. And he came in with his whole list of stuff, which included firing both drivers. And so, fortunately, Herb went to bat for me, and he says, we'll fire one of them, but we will not, we're sticking with Kendall. And so, Bob Riley designed that 90 Beretta, which I look back on it. Back then, I convinced myself it looked like a Beretta. It's one of the wilder looking pieces ever. And Judy was a part of that program, and we kicked off in fine style. We didn't win a race until Cleveland, but the team was clicking. They were adding weight to us even before we won, but won six races that year and won the championship away from Roush. And Chris Neifel was my teammate. We were the Twin Towers of Trans Am. And it was really, really a cool program, and that really
stuff, even though I won the three championships. Trans Am was finally getting into the big leagues, and you were running with in front of big crowds. You were the sport race for IndyCar weekends on Saturday. It was really great, Trans Am on Saturday. And actually, we ran at the Glen. We ran with the Cup, Winston Cup. One story about that race, which sticks in my craw, one of the races that Neifel won, they were adding weight to us, and so we were kind of starting to manage how quick we were showing in practice, and so it was really getting bad. They'd added weight a couple times, and they said, listen, we're really racing Dorsey. We're not racing the Dodgers. We're not racing anyone else. We're racing Dorsey, so we're going to key off of him. We don't want you qualifying up front. We need to be near the front. And so I think I qualified fifth, which was really worse qualifying all year. And so before the race, Thean says, yeah, just kind of watch him. I don't want you leading. If someone else is leading, let him go. Keep your eye on Dorsey, blah, blah, blah. And so I'm running around like fifth place, whatever. And Neifel is like going to the front. And he's all over the leader. And then I'm like, technically he's not leading, but it's obvious he could be. It wasn't a very good show, I didn't think. So all of a sudden, I think Dorsey dropped out, or maybe it was the Saisapa car. All of a sudden, I say on the radio, I said, what's the deal? He said, deal's off, go for it. And I'm like, fifth. And Neifel is way out in front. Neifel and Feehan were really, really close for a lot of years. And so there was a little interesting team dynamic going on. So I got on my horse, and I started reeling in Neifel. I caught him on the last lap. I got up next to him on the back straightaway, and he ran me into the grass, and we were about to almost wreck, and I was hot. And so we run the short course, coming back, and I got partway alongside him, coming into the final corner with a checker. And I felt like I was far enough alongside that if we hit it, it was going to be at least shared responsibility. But something told me that that argument wasn't probably going to hold a lot of water. And so I got out of it. He chopped across. He won the race, and I felt like I'd been kind of hosed. And I was, as racers, you're totally, everything is egocentric. It doesn't matter team goals. All you're thinking about is how it affects you. So, but Neifel won. That was his first win of the year. I'd won, I think, four or five at that point. And so, but that was a little Trans Am related trivia inside story. And then one of his friends was an artist. He did a picture of that. And he wanted me to sign it. I said, I'm not signing.
Well, over the years, there's obviously been conflicts between the sanctioning group and the race teams and the manufacturers, so I know there are stories. Now, I don't know if Woody's story about oil pan testing at Elkhart Lake has any connection to SCCA's rules, but I know you have a story.
I do have a story. Before I do that, I want to clear one thing up. In deference to my counterparts around me, I never attended nor graduated from General Motors Institute. When we took over when Roger signed the deal with American Motors to take on the Javelin project, it was a big project because there wasn't much to start with. The Kaplan, the prior team was really all they left was a piles of junk in Southern California, and we really had to start from scratch. There was an engine program in place from 67, I believe, 68, where Traco had built the AMC motors, and they were pretty successful at it. They had good power. But when we got that, in 1969 and 70, you were not allowed to dry sump. The rules were, stock oil pump and basically a stock oil pan, although they didn't bother you too much on the oil pan. And we used the stock oil pump, and we took our best shot at the oil pan, and we learned that in racing or testing, if there were some long corners the carousel at Elkhart Lake or the like, we were losing engine bearings. We were losing oil pressure. And it cost us a number of races early in the 1970 season. And Mark decided that we needed to fix it, do something. So he had me, you couldn't remove the oil pan in the Javelin without pulling the engine. And he had me take one of the two cars, race cars, and cut the center section out of the front cross member and put flanges on it so I could bolt the cross member in and out. And he got five different aftermarket Southern California hot rod types to build five different configurations of oil pans. One of them was actually a big circle that had the oil pump feed came out of the center, and it was in a bearing that had this big thing swinging around no matter what direction it went. Anyway, that didn't work. But we went to Elkhart Lake for 3 days of testing, and we tested oil pans. And back then, we didn't have recorders. And Mark says, you know, I can't drive the car and watch the oil pressure gauge. Unless I can, but then I can't go as fast as I need to go to see if we can destroy the engine. So he says, you're going to have to ride in the back. So I would change the oil pan. And then I'd climb in the roll cage, and there was no seat back there, and there was no seat belt. I would kind of look like a monkey with a roll cage looking right over his shoulder, and he would go out and do laps through that carousel, I mean, just absolutely as fast as he was qualifying, and I'd watch the oil pressure gauge. And I'm up, down. I think we tried four different oil pans, and we finally came up with one that would live through the carousel, and we went home, and I don't believe we ever failed another engine. But I was black and blue for a month.
Now, every team has one or two or three DAGs, data acquisition geeks. That was a data acquisition stud.
Well, I don't know if this system's working.
Yeah.
Yes. I did a similar thing. Mark, we were trying to learn something about pressures and airflow and on the car, and so we were at I think it was Donnybrook. I didn't really know about this before, but apparently it was something that tricked Donnie, played on everybody. But I was ended up strapped into the back of a Camaro using the same straps that you would tie the car down with in the trailer, and trying to read these manometers as he was out driving, and it became kind of clear early on that this wasn't working so well. So the plan was that we would go out and try to run a constant speed down the straightaway, you know, so many RPM, constant speed for the length of the straightaway, and then we'd go in and make changes, and then go back out and run the same constant speed, and try to see if we got any difference in these water manometers. This is the crudest thing you could ever imagine. And but Donahue grew impatient and with the whole process. So he just started driving really fast. And I'm back there scared half to death. And I looked up one time, and we were going down the straightaway. And we're not going the standard, you know, 100 miles an hour. He's just flat out. And I'm seeing, you know, the RPMs of 7,500. And then I look at the turn coming up, and I look over at his helmet, and I look at the turn coming up, and he's not moving, and I'm convinced that he's dead. And all at once, you know, the car, he jumps on the brakes, the car slows down, and turns. I couldn't. To this day, I wake up in the middle of the night.
I have a story similar. During the Trans Am series with the Camaro, winning at Riverside, when Mark won at Riverside, I think that clinched the championship. And it would be the only time that I said that I would ever ride in the passenger seat with the flag. And so they put me in there, pictures of me being pushed in and dragged out, because as soon as Mark saw it was me in the passenger seat and I was given the flag to hold, I held on to that flag so hard, and he drove a regular, normal Trans Am racing lap with me in the passenger seat without a seatbelt. And when we got back, the flag was in tatters. It was totally destroyed, but I held on to it till the bitter end. But that was Mark. He was a prankster for sure. I think Lee has a story.
Oh, I think that's a driver thing too, because I rode around in the car, squatted on my haunches in the front seat with George Fulmer going around mid-Ohio, and we were third on the grid at the time with me in it. But along Woody's stories, we have some good oil pan stories too, because essentially the Ford engine sits in front of the cross member and the oil pan section is in front of the engine. So essentially whenever you accelerate, all the oil goes to the back and you lose the oil pressure. So Ford had this miraculous electronic timing or sensor so they could tell when it was bad and this sort of thing. And they said, you got to do something with the oil pan. Well, it became a competition between Carcraft and Ford engine and foundry because both of us were trying to do a proper oil pan for the thing. Well, we at Carcraft, we had an oil pan with a little plastic thing over the top in the back of a station wagon. So we had different little sensors, one of the pickups, one of the things like Woody was saying as far as on a pivot, so it could pivot around. Another one we had was from a jet aircraft that sits in one of the oil tanks there, and it's like a lead weight on the end of a flexible thing, which the Ford management called the Dick pickup. And we, you know, got dizzy riding in the station wagon, watching the oil move around, that sort of thing. So the final solution was the guy that was my design guy came up with a double oil oil pump driven by the same shaft, and then we had a pickup in the back of the thing plus various windows and that sort of thing. So essentially part of the oil pan picked up in the back and dumped in the front, and then the proper oil pan pump could pick it up. Well, Ford E&F at the same time designed this cast aluminum pan, and it was near Christmas, and one of the Ford guys came in and he was on crutches, and Ford, Fran Hernandez said to him, what happened, you drop your oil pan on your foot? So and that oil pan never saw the light of day because it was about 60 pounds, something like that.
One quick comment. I want to stage a revolt against the 1960-70 Trans Am because you had a cheating oil pump. You were only allowed one.
That's a two-stage pump.
Speaking of cheating,
yeah.
And the loopholes and the rules. That was one of Roger's great calls, is to read the loopholes and work them to the team's benefit. So I know all of you have something to do with that. And the Ford people? What about acid dipping and all of those things?
You know, we were at the LA airport, and there was some chassis sitting there that were going to be shipped back to the Midwest. And so they were acid dipped and they were Camaros. And we rode on the thing, this chassis is not legal for Trans Am.
I have a funny dipping story. This is I believe everybody dipped their cars.
No.
I know both of the Posey's cars were dipped, and I know Chuck's cars were dipped, right?
No.
That's expired.
My story. We did acid dip the 70 Javelins, and I'm sorry, the 69 Camaros. And when they were finished painted, just before, right when we finished painting, and we never noticed, the roofs were a little bit rippled. Didn't look quite right. We had no time to replace the roofs. So Mark went down the street and got one of these Landau roof guys to come in the shop, and they put rubber roofs on both cars. And we went off to the races with a Landau roof on the two Camaros. And the Ford guys didn't like it. And they're complaining to John Tamanis, the head of technical inspection, just the greatest guy. And he come over and asked me, you know, Woody, off the side, you know, what's with the rubber roof? And I said, it makes it look good, you know, Roger. So we get to about the fourth or fifth race, and Ford had, and we're beating it bad. And Ford was really putting a lot of pressure on the SCCA. And Tamanis comes over to me again, gets me off the side. Woody, you got to tell me what's going on with the rubber roofs. And I said, John, I can't believe you ever figured it out. It's a golf ball effect.
And he looks at me and he says, "What do you mean golf ball effect?" I said, "Have you ever held a golf ball?" "Yeah." "Doesn't it have little dimples all over it?" I says, "Yeah." I said, "John, that creates lift." And he just walked away shaking his
head. I have a similar story. As a Chevrolet representative, I had a fleet of Chevrolets and usually Camaros in New York City to give to media to write stories about. And at the same time, Jim Hall was running the Chaparral Camaros. And they were being sort of checked by SEC. SEC would never go to the manufacturer to get the accurate, what they think was accurate information, because they didn't trust the manufacturers to give them accurate information. So Jim Hall shows up with a head with splayed valves in it. They said, "That can't be stopped." So I go to a party somewhere in New York, I don't know what event it had to do with, and John Tomatis was there, and I drive in with one of my Chevrolet cars, and it's a Camaro, and John says, "Oh, let me take a look at that car." He opens up the hood, he looks in, and he says, "Oh, dang, it's got splayed valves." He says, "Then you were put up by the Chevrolet to bring this car to this party. I know it, and they spent it." And I swore that's what they believed, that it was clearly not true. It was even when I raced the Chevy Monza, they wouldn't believe that I was a Chevrolet representative, and I gave them the stats and the technical details about the car, and they wouldn't believe me because I represented Chevrolet in any event. So coming back to more recent, so in your 1 year, Butch, you had some issues, traction control.
Yeah, it was a very interesting year. Yeah. I drove a Tommy Bahama Corvette for Tom Floyd, and the first two or three races I did a pretty poor job. But then we got on a roll, and we won a few races in a row. And at that time, this was 2002, traction control was the kind of magic powder. If you had traction control, you would win everything. And I never actually saw it, but apparently in Speed Sport News, somebody advertised that's like a chip, just something that you kind of put on your MSD box, on the ignition box, and it gave you traction control. So everyone was convinced, and it was supposed to be like this big, you could hide it in your pocket. So everyone was convinced if someone did well, they obviously had traction control. So we were at Trois Rivières, and I won. And afterwards, we pulled on the track in front of the pits, and I got out, and no one was there, which was kind of odd. And I looked over, and I saw the team was kind of corralled over in this area. So I ran over to them, high five and stuff. And they all just kind of had their hands in their pockets and were kind of standing there. So, and then an official said, "Get out of here. You get back over there." So this is really weird. And I walked back over to the car, and then someone comes over and says, "There's an ambulance parked there." And they said, "Go into that ambulance." This is really weird. But the victory circle was on the other end of the street, and I thought, well, maybe there's going to be a ride down there. So I get in the back of this ambulance, close the door behind me, and these two people, the doctors in the front, just gave me this look, and one of them said, "We're really sorry about this, Butch." What the hell have I gotten into? And they made me do a strip search. This thing on me somewhere. And it took a little bit of the shine off the race, I have to say. and they didn't find anything, obviously. But they tore the car down quite a bit. They took the MSD boxes. And they're going to send them out to testing, and then the next race was, I think, Road America. And we got there, and they were supposed to be returning the MSD boxes. Well, we don't have them yet. And Bill Fingerlow, who's our team manager, I'm sure you know, said, "Well, can we use, instead of having to buy new boxes, we have two from last year. Can we use those?" And apparently from the year before to this year, they were still, that you had to use this spec MSD box, but the year before you were allowed to put silicone all over to keep the bits from rattling off, but the year I was racing you couldn't. They said, "Well, we've got these from last year, can we use these instead of making us buy new ones because you didn't get finished. So I said, okay. So we got through that weekend. The next weekend at Denver, after the race, one of the other teams looked at our MSD box and said, hey, those aren't the spec MSD box. And the SCCA guy, the tech guy, who approved it, said, oh yeah, you're right. and that started off this long legal thing. Tom actually hired a lawyer and spent a lot of money, basically for the rest of the year going through appeals and things. And what ended up happening is they kind of did one of these, well, you weren't really at fault, but you were still kind of at fault, so they gave us the win back, but they took points away or something like that. So and really the net effect of all of it was that Tom Glow got so fed up with everything that he just packed it all in at the end of the year and that was it. But it was a very very interesting year.
And your dad said that's what they did to me when they told me they. Now I have to ask you, was Paul Genelozzi in the series at Trauma the Ed? That's usually where these things start.
he was pretty good about kind of pointing the finger around. You know, it was a little bit of the Richard Petty syndrome, I think. You know, they must be cheating because I'm cheating and they're beating me. Yeah.
Well, the traction control thing didn't start in 2002. I first started getting it in 1990 with the Berettas, and we had this separate fifth wheel, Chaparral, and that's where the Chevy engineers worked out of, and that was their office. Everyone was convinced that this was NASA control, and this is where all the stuff that was being manipulated, and that's where the traction control was being beamed to space or something. And so they came up with this idea that one of the races, I think it was Road Atlanta, right before the start of the race, they were going to go over there, and they put a padlock on the trailer, and they said, you guys can't go in there. And they said, okay. And we won. The car still ran and so forth. So that's where the traction control started. In 97, when we were on that streak, it reached a fevered pitch, and the car got torn apart every single weekend. And finally, between races on like a midweek, there was a call at the shop at Roush, and they said, we want to inspect your car at the shop. And they're like, okay. They're like, when? They're like, right now, we're here. And they did a sneak attack. And we're like, knock yourselves out. You know. And so they went, did all this stuff. And Genelozzi is a smart guy. But what he does is he observes something, and then he works backwards and creates this crazy, I'm not sure there really was a module for sale in Speed Sport News. But when he tells the story, he'll say, I know it. You can buy it. I've spoken to the guy.
And actually, that was one of the things that Boris told me. Boris said was racing at the same time. We raced at Cleveland, and in qualifying, this is my first time at Cleveland, and I did a poor job of reading the schedule, and I went out and set a time, and my plan was to come in, bleed the tire pressures down, and go back out for a second run. So I did a time, came in the pits, Tom Gloy puts the window net down, and said, what are you doing? It's a 10-minute session. And put the fear of God into me. They put the thing up, and I got out of the pits really quick. And I set a time, and I got on pole. But Boris told me that Paul came over to him afterwards and said, did you see that? Oh, they're totally cheating. Because he came in the pits, they just took the window net down, put the window net back up. And then he gets pole somehow. Boris is a good guy. Just looked at him with a dead face and said, oh, well, they're cheating.
Well, Tommy, I do remember at one point when SCCA was penalizing drivers for being too fast.
It was kind of what's evolved. It's out of control today. It's what BOP is today, balance of performance. Back then, you know, they would adjust. They wouldn't do it every race, but they would kind of tell you, you know, if you stick up the show and you get too big a lead, we're going to put up the pace car and so forth. And so, but that 1990 season, they added weight. We had a splayed valve, fuel-injected V6 Beretta. One thing I learned is you don't want to be the only person running a package because it's easy for them to zap you and slow you down. And so that they added weight to the point where the end of the year, we were with the V6, we were the exact same weight as the race cars. And so Chevy, we were battling for the championship, and so they ran a third Beretta with R.K. Smith, and they went back to a non-splay valve head with a carburetor, and that allowed the car to run 175 pounds lighter. And so it's weird. I mean, that's where I gained my appreciation for weight and the effect on performance, because RK ran the car at Mid-Ohio. We clinched the manufacturer's title, or the driver's title, at Mid-Ohio. And then we get to Elkhart on the test day, and RK was used to, he was a formula car guy. He didn't have a lot of experience with sedans, so they said, RK wants you to drive his car and make sure it's, everything's in the window and so forth. So I got in his car and went out on the Thursday, and I went out for three laps, and I came in and I told Dan Binks, my crew chief, I said, I'm racing this car. He says, what do you mean? I said, I'm racing this car. This thing is so much faster. It had less power. It was 175 pounds lighter. And I raced that car, and it was one of the easier wins I ever had. I remember going down the straightaway into turn five with the other, some of the Mustangs and stuff. I remember just looking at them, not even really paying that much attention to the brake markers, thinking, I'm just going to wait until they brake. And when they brake, then I'll brake. And that's how I worked my way to the front. And so I ended up, I own that car today. It's how it drove off the racetrack at St. Pete. But I get the why you want to try to equalize, but it just kind of underscores that it's really, really hard to do any sort of equivalency formulas in racing. And I really think they need to figure out a better way than BOP to do it. Basically, where it got to in the 90s was everybody ran a 300-inch, same carburetor, and then if you're getting beat, you're just getting beat. And so it opens the can of worms where whoever's their last threatening to withdraw gets the extra sugar. And so it was a nightmare. It was part of the deal. It wasn't too bad. When you're in the middle of it, you think it's the worst thing ever, and they're all out to get you and so forth. So one thing I've learned up here from this, Roger Penske, if you sponsored his cars, you were going to win races, and you were going to lose people at the end of the year. Because it looks like he poached people, and they stayed with him for the rest of the time.
Roger was excellent at that. In fact, many of the people who are still with him or have retired recently were there early on, and he snatched them from American Motors, from Sears, from Chevrolet. He has a great knack of putting the right people together.
Was Roger always together? There got to be some moments where he showed up and his hair wasn't combed.
Never happened.
I did a Facebook Live this morning, and I looked in the mirror afterwards, and my eyebrow was like all crazy. I just did a broadcast to 5,000 people, so I could never drive for Roger. That's why I never drove for Roger.
I did see him drink a glass of wine once.
So I was just at an event this weekend. I met someone who said, oh, well, I saw Roger Penske at NASA. And I was walking by, and he said, hey, guy, can you give me a hand? And he was the only guy on his car. And he said, could you tape my helmet, please, because I can't see with the sun shining in the eye. So this guy's shining moment was to put two strips of tape on his visor so he could see in the sun.
All right, my next, I don't know, this might be a good time to now jump again to current season, and Amy Roonen as the reigning champion, and now with a couple of races left, she is leading in the points, and you say she's tied?
Yep.
Oh, I saw 1 point difference, but okay. And so we can move from the stage and take a break. If necessary, and let people watch Amy's. Oh, and let me give you a little bit of Amy's background. She's the first female Trans Am champion in the history of the Trans Am. Has worked her way up to the championship with her family-centered team. Was a podium finisher at the 2010 SCCA runoffs in GT1, and then turned to Trans Am. Has competed in all Trans Am series for the past 5 years. Finished second in 2012, fourth in 2013, and third in 2014. Won her first Trans Am race in 2011 and had her first pole in 2014. In 2015, won the last three races of the year to finish the title. And then we'll be back and we'll continue.
This is Josh Ashby with the Motor Racing Research Center interviewing Amy Roonen here, Trans Am Series driver, for our conversation, of course, on the Trans Am Series. Once again, welcome back to Watkins Glen, Amy.
Thanks.
I know I've said that a few times.
Great to be back.
First off, what does the Trans Am Series mean to you? Not only as a driver, but I'm assuming a fan since your father did run it for a few years.
It's obviously very important to us. It's legendary in our minds and actually I think in the U.S. So personally, it means a lot to me, especially to get to the level we're at today with winning the championship. And with my dad being in the series for so long and us being a part of it, it's great to continue on the tradition of running in the series. And I quite frankly think it's one of the most exciting road racing series out there.
You've made some history being the first woman to win the championship. How does it feel to be in the same record book as Gurney, Donahue, Jones, Fulmer, Posey, and Revson, just to be in the same record book?
Yeah, to be mentioned with those names clearly is absolutely an honor. Like I said, it's really legendary, the series overall, if you go back through and look at the history of it and who's running it. And, you used to take a step back and you're like, wow, I really am in that group now. And, I don't really compare myself with people, but, you know, to do what we did and to achieve what we achieved on our own, you know, as a single base privateer team, a family-run base team, and to come where we were to fruition today is really an honor. And, it's exciting. We're still excited about it, and we're trying to come back this year and defend the title again. And being a first at anything is it's exciting. It doesn't matter what it is. But I think we've definitely made a mark for ourselves.
All right, speaking to Trans Am's history, over the last 50 years, the cars have changed a lot from basically showroom stock cars with a cage and several modifications, shall we say, thrown in there to today's purpose-built Trans Am car. What do you think is one of the best changes that happened, and where do you see the Trans Am series being in the next 15 to 20 years?
Well, clearly, we're excited to have the kind of horsepower that we run with the big motors that we're running, 358s now, the power we put down is incredible. I think that's exciting. I think it gives the transition of the series over the 50 years, people can still relate to our cars. We're trying to, with the TA2 class, bring in kind of that Pony War type tradition that they used to run. So I think definitely still there's a crossover into the mainstream American that they can still relate to us. But, everybody just likes to watch a fast race car. So that's really where it's at for us. It's all about power and getting out there and giving the fans a show.
And you definitely do that. I know when you were up here earlier this year, we had some students coming in for the Green Grand Prix, and as soon as they saw your car, they're like, oh my God, look, just imagining. Right. And of course you turned it over, and then they were like, whoa.
Yeah.
If you look at the tracks that Trans Am has run over its entire history, you see that some of America's best racetracks. What track, present or past, would you like to see on the race schedule? Even if the track is shut down,
I'd love to run it. I'm glad that Watkins Glen clearly is back on the schedule for us this year. This is my favorite racetrack. I've said that throughout the years. It's just one of a kind here, and especially with the new improvements that they've made with the pavement, it's going to be unbelievable fast. And there's just so many different elements to this racetrack that just are really fun to drive. We do have the opportunity to race at all the best racetracks around the country. It's a little more expensive for us to go out to the West Coast now, but I wouldn't mind seeing Laguna Seca back on the schedule if we did some sort of West Coast swing. And also, I'm a fan of the street course. If we could get back on the schedule we're going to be running at the Detroit Grand Prix this year. So that'll be exciting to be back on track. I was fond of Three Rivers for street tracks, Toronto, Long Beach. I would love to see some of those come back. But probably just mainstream road course, you know, Watkins Glen. I'm not saying that just because I'm here, but no, I've said that throughout my career. It's pretty much my favorite racetrack.
What do you think, not only as a driver, but an entrant as well, do you think makes Trans Am such a lasting series? You know, to make it 50 years when some series are like five and done, if they're lucky.
Right. I think, you know, the passion is with the competitors. It's never left. The fans have never left us. They've always been supportive. And like I said, I think our format works. We're a 100-mile race. It's exciting to watch for, you know, 70 minutes, 75 minutes worth of racing. You have to get it done in that amount of time, so it's intense while you're out there. I think that model works with the fans, and I think it works with us competitors. It takes away the element of a pit stop or things that could go wrong with driver changes and things like that. It's just a different nature versus endurance racing. But I think each series brings its own different element, and I think that's our strong suit, to be a 100-mile sprint race, to get it done and make it really exciting for the fans to watch.
What's the closest finish you've ever had?
Oh, boy. I'd say, wow, that's a lot of races for me to review. One of the top finishes, I'd have to say, in my career thus far was the COTA race last year. It came down to Cliff Eben and I on the last lap, and on a restart close to the end of the race, and he had gotten by me, and then we came back around, and we were side by side. I took him into one. We were side by side through one, down the hill, through the whole entire S's at COTA, then up that little hill on the back, and I finally was able to pass him, and that was the last lap, and I won. So probably, off the top of my head, that's a pretty good finish for us.
Obviously, including yours, what is your favorite car? When you think of Trans Am, what car comes to your head?
Oh, the number 23 McNichols Corvette, of course. I can't deny that.
Of course, yeah.
You know, that's...
She served you well.
Yes, both of them. We got our first win in my dad's original car at the end of 2011. That was our first win. We were going to park the car. We had purchased a newer one. And so to get the win in that, our very first win in that car, was exciting for us. And it was fitting end to it. Although we did get it back out of retirement once or twice. But so I got to go with my favorite car is, of course, my car.
All right. Well, thank you again. I appreciate this so much.
Sure. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, and hopefully you'll end with a win again this weekend.
Hopefully. We're looking forward to it.
All right.
This year during the Petit Le Mans, a lot was made about Christina Nielsen being the first female major motorsports champion in America. And we... that was not true, because Amy Ruman was.
Hearing her there, it's all privateers now. There's no factory involvement there. And it really takes you back to when you first got started. And those teams, it's her dad, it's her sister, it's her. And I mean, the extra few bucks for an extra West Coast race and all the things. And so she just really kind of, the core appeal of Trans Am has always been the privateers that support. And they're the ones that have kept it alive, because the factories come and go. And so it's cool to see they have the big fields, and she touched on that big power. Those things are nasty, those new cars. And like every driver, your car is your favorite car. So, the pictures, you always picture it, the new season, the new paint job, what it's going to look like. And like Junior Johnson said, I've never seen an ugly car in Victory Lane. So.
So we'll be doing questions in a little while, but just a couple of leftover items. If Lee Dykstra, you had some other slides you wanted to show, or
why don't you go forward about three of them?
Okay, so go forward.
Okay, so here's, I included some of the guys on the panel there. So here's Chuck. with us at testing at Riverside, essentially with a 68 Mustang. Now this is a car that you see in the museum or the sister to it. And we're testing aero stuff at Riverside, as long as you can see the little bubble in the hood. So that was a Gurney Westlake engine in the thing. So trying to give the driver an idea of something, a proper motor in the thing, as opposed to the tunnel port Ford, which had, you know, zero torque from about zero to 7,000 RPM. So this is the first one. Go ahead, we'll show the car. So this is our first 69 car coming out of the shop at the Carcraft. And Judy is probably familiar with it, because this is the car that somehow or another the SCCA scoring missed the lap, and Parnelli did an extra lap before he got the checkered flag. And the timing and scoring stuff happened to be in Roger's plane heading out after, right after the race. On the next one. This is the car we built for Smokey Unick. Absolutely for a Ford vice president type of thing. It had to be absolutely perfect, and it never ran and got cut up by torches to run on a circle track. So. Okay, so this is actually the first car test in the Lockheed Wind Tunnel in Atlanta. They didn't have the ability to drive the car into the tunnel, so we had to drop it from the ceiling through a hole in the tunnel. So here it is, about 60 feet in the air, supported by the four cables as we're dropping it in for the aero test. Keep going. Okay, so there's a hole in the tunnel to drop the car through the ceiling. Keep going. Here we are standing underneath it. So you can see Fran Hernandez over here. It's myself in the center, and Mitch Marshy, who is my design engineer under there. So we're lowering the car into place. And now they can drive the car in the tunnel, and everybody and his brother is testing it in the Lockheed Tunnel. But this is the first time through. Okay, so here, some of this stuff you probably haven't seen. I think this is in one of the Trans Am books or something that people have, as far as some of the additions we had in the front spoiler, trying to get front downforce in the car. Go to the next one. Here's the adjustable rear wing on the back. That's that full chap there. So we ran through the angles as far as the rear wing is concerned. Okay, so this is a windshield wiper test. You can see the wiper straight up. So that's the minimum drag position for the wiper. Now there just happens to be this funny looking thing on the roof there, which sort of looks like the rear wing that was on the back there. One of the Ford guys thought that maybe you could put downforce in the middle of the car this way so it was balanced. Needless to say, it didn't quite work because the air sort of flowing the wrong direction there.
Thank you. And I think, Chuck, did you have something to add and some slides to show?
Well, the 66 season was the first season. That was run pretty much by independent people. A.J. Foyt drove in the first race at Sebring. It was only a seven-race series. The cars were pretty, they had to have the complete interiors, including back seats and all of the floor mats and everything, all the carpet. So they were sort of a strange thing from what people have been racing before. And they had a single carburetor, which gave about 350 horsepower. For 67, when the teams got involved, SCCA allowed larger wheels. They had to be homologated cars, but they had larger wheels and two carburetors set up, and they had about 400 horsepower. That's what we raced with that year. The season started for us in the Mustang. We got our cars late in the year after the first of the year and had to build up two cars to get to Daytona in February, which was pretty strict schedule. We didn't have time to paint the cars, but ran them there. Titus blew a tire on the banking and managed to save it at 160 mile an hour, which was probably a good deal, because the only safety structure we had in those cars at that time was a roll bar, and that wouldn't have done much good if you went into the fence. The Sebring race, we got the cars painted and took them. Titus was on the pole. He beat the pole time from the year before by 18 seconds. And, you know, Farnelli was right behind him and Thompson right behind him. So, but all the cars were much faster than they had done the year before. We had a lot of, next race at Green Valley, Titus rolled the car in the afternoon, tore it up really badly, and the crew worked all night on it and rebuilt it. And it looked like a new car when it came back on the track. That was a real hot race, and we didn't have it. And so we went through the season. We got tired pretty badly at Ryer in the rain and lost that car. And then by the end of the year, after the last race, next to the last race at Stardust, Donahue had won two races. Shelby and the Mustang had won four races, and the Cougars had won four races, so the points were very close. So we went to the last race at Kent Raceway, and we didn't see that car, and Titus had a practice crash, which really destroyed the car. There wasn't any overnight fix for that car. And so Putnam drove our other team car, of course, and Titus drove John McComb's car, which blew up. So during the race, anyway, Mark Donahue and the Camaro ran away with everything. And so the championship boiled down to who got second place, whether a Cougar or a Mustang. And Farnelli had blown up, but before he blew up, he'd showered Gurney's windshield with rocks. And Buckingham's car was overheating, but Buckingham was in second, and Gurney was in third. Buckingham trying to keep the car from blowing up, and Gurney trying to keep the windshield from falling in on his lap. And so they ran around that way, and Buckingham ended up getting the second place, and that gave us the championship for Mustang with a two-point edge. It had 12 races that year, and they took the best nine out of the 12 races. And we had a seven-point advantage on Bruce, but when they took the best nine, we were down to two-point lead. So it was a really close championship. The Cougar tech inspection at the end of a race was they would take the car off the track and weigh the car. Bud Moore convinced the stewards that because everybody started the race on brand new tires, he would like to start put new tires on a car before they went and weighed the cars. But what they didn't know is that the new tires that Bud put on a car were half full of water. That had a little weight, and then at one race they found a helmet in the passenger seat with a bar of lead on it.
I was walking with Bud Moore to the inspection, and he was walking with the weights all in his pockets, and they were hanging. And I said, "What?" And he said, "Just for free." And I was just looking and chatting with somebody who's throwing into the helmet. And Charlie Rains walked up and said, "Oh, we got to move that helmet." He moved to pick up the helmet.
Yeah, and sure, and they didn't do anything about this kind of violation because the competition was so good, and the whole racing scene was so attractive. The Trans Am cars, they were really a fun car to watch for spectators and for anybody that was involved with the cars. It was just the beginning of as we heard here, how it's progressed up and down over the years. It was certainly a good beginning for the Trans Am series.
Great. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you very much. And we'll open it up. If you have a question, please raise your hand if I can see you. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Judy. Eddie, you talked about acid dipping bodies. Were there acid dipped engines too?
No, not to my knowledge.
No, the bodies are quite were trucked out. I believe there was only one company that did it. It was in Southern Illinois.
Use the microphone.
Torrance.
Microphone.
There was only one company that could do it, and it was in Torrance, California. Bodies in white would be shipped out there. I witnessed the 70 cars being dipped.
And
with Mark, and they would only do it at night because there was a, it looked like it would have been a cloud of mustard gas going up.
Well, in Donahue's book, it talks about a series of engines taken off the line at Tonawanda in Buffalo and acid dipped, and then taken back to be put back on the line to be finished, and that they were painted pastel colors. You don't know that story?
I was never involved there. I don't recall ever hearing about it.
Okay.
And I've read the Mark's book a couple times, don't recall reading about it.
Well, it's in there, and I went to Tonawanda for a tour a year ago, and they talked to the history guy there, and he said, must have happened on a weekend.
I think those minions when they came to Chevrolet were, Mark lost track, the Chevrolet lost track of them.
Yeah.
So we never got the damage for the,
yeah,
the users.
Are any of you guys working with Historic Trans Am to ensure that the cars continue to be illegal?
I have been asked to look at a couple of cars to give my judgment as to whether they were our cars. And I've done that on a number of occasions. All of our Camaros, there were two missing up until recently. The Bucknum car from 69 was sold to a Mexican businessman, and it was in storage in an underground garage under a tall office building when the 1984 earthquake in Mexico City came down, and it's down there a few hundred feet still, never to be seen again. The one missing 67 car, which went to Germany, was just acquired in pieces by Pat Ryan, and it is now in Asheville, South Carolina. All the rest are alive and well. I think most of them are in Southern California. I've seen all of them. They're all painted Sunoco blue, and not one color matches the next one.
Okay, back there.
Can anybody offer any credence to the story that, and I don't know the race, but I think it was Donahue and Palmer both qualified the same car for the race?
Donahue and Palmer were never on the same team in Trans Am.
Donahue and Fisher, but Donahue qualified, I think, at Sebring, both cars for himself and for Fisher. And the cars were different. One of them had vents and one of them didn't have vents, but they just changed the numbers and nobody paid attention to the vents.
Just if you can clear up any of you on the stage, the old Hertz Renner racer and light at Brock Yates just passing away, wasn't there a story about they took a Shelby 350 and actually raced it and sent it back to Hertz after the race? Or is that a figment of my imagination?
Well, there were a lot of stories about the Hertz cars being raced. We don't think any of them are really valid, but in one race, Tommy Yeager borrowed the carburetor off of John Bishop's GT350 Hertz car that he had and used it on his race car. And I think the Marlboro Trans Am that happened.
Brock could have started the story.
He could have.
He would. He's a script writer. Was a script writer, an excellent one. And of course, used editorial license every time. Who else? Oh, yes, go ahead.
I don't know a lot about the race cars, but when you're talking about the acid dipping, I guess that's to take weight off of the metal. The Corvettes that you've seen here, do they have fiberglass bodies like the street cars? So you wouldn't do acid dipping with the Corvette, I guess.
Eventually, they transition to removable fiberglass and then carbon fiber bodies, so all the cars had fiberglass later on. Starting in probably the late 70s?
When my dad did it, was still year by.
It was,
yeah. So like 82, 83,
they were done. When you're talking about that performance equalization and all these formulas and this and that, I mean, it seemed like metal body race cars and fiberglass race cars would be Did they run in separate classes, or I mean,
you had a minimum weight that everybody had to meet. But what the acid dipping would do is it would get the weight, and you could put it down lower in the car, so you would get
lower the center of gravity.
It lowers the center of gravity, yeah. And that's they're obsessive. I mean, they were pretty obsessive, obviously, back then. So, but it continues today. The lengths they'll go to. This is not Trans Am related, but I heard that Formula One had to pass a rule probably 15, 20 years ago now, that prohibiting the teams from using depleted uranium as ballast because it was denser. And so they were going to use, you would think that common sense, but if it's faster, someone will do it. And if someone does it, everyone has to do it.
That's my way to get rid of the radioactive waste.
Yeah.
We Ford did lightweight stamping, so essentially we didn't have to do the acid dipping as far as fenders, hoods, glass, all these sorts of things.
Yeah, those beautiful Bud Morph cars. I remember one of the guys that owned one that you could literally bend the deck lid with your finger. It was just really light gauge metal. I drove Parnelli's car. Ford brought us both to the proving grounds in I think probably '96 or '97. And Parnelli drove my car and I drove his car. And the seat, it only came up to about here. Now, granted, I was taller than Parnelli, but my shoulder blades were over the seat. And there was a lever down here that the seat belts went into this cord. And the cord went down into this little mechanism. And when you flip this lever, it would unlock so that you could reach forward and he could get to the switches and maybe wipe the windshield when it was before. And then you go back here and lock it down. And I was thinking, that doesn't seem terribly safe. And I drove that car, and I'm like, man, I had admiration for Parnelli before that, but after driving that car, I said, man, what an absolute stud. And kind of underscoring that, he got out of my car, and he was, let's see, this was almost 20 years ago, so he was in his 60s. He says, if I knew they were this easy to drive now, I'd still be driving.
Hi, Judy Stropus,
Kendall
and Butch Leitzinger.
I do. It's funny. I had them all socked away, and my dad called me and said, "You got to get all this crap out of here." And it was good because it was like a barn find, but it was all my own stuff. And so I mean, I found some. I knew I had those cars, but I mean, in terms of some trophies and posters and stuff like that. So I shipped all of them. I have four of my old race cars. My first five championships represented, and I shipped them all back to Dan Binks in Michigan, and the goal is to get him out for some vintage racing, but every time he calls me, it's at least $7,500. So I said, just space these calls out. And I sound like a total jerk, because I didn't have to pay for anything when I was doing it. And I didn't care what it costs. I'm like, what do you mean you don't have to put any brake rotors? I'm going to need new brake rotors. And so I'm hoping to get some of them out. The first one that's going to be out, the RX-7 that I won my first two GT titles with, nobody has seen that. It's the winningest RX-7 in history. No one has seen it in almost 30 years. And so it'll be at Amelia Island next year in the show, and then hopefully a race shortly thereafter. The Beretta is, all those cars, fortunately, they don't have to be put back. Like a lot of cars, you have to kind of reconstruct what they were because they had a different body or different this, a different that. Those are all like they drove off the racetrack. And that Beretta has 1 year on it. And the sister car that I drove more of the season, the former president of Cars and Concepts sold that to Bruce Canepa last year. And so it's been out a little bit. And so there's only three of those Berettas. They're all accounted for. But the Beretta is probably the closest to being ready to race. Needs everything that has rubber in it. Needs to be fixed and changed, aero quit and stuff like that. But the goal is to get them out for a race or two here pretty soon.
Butch, being the young rookie that you were that year in 2002, what other tracks besides Cleveland was your first time at?
Good question. Long Beach. Let's see. There was a race at Washington D.C. around RFK. That was really cool. Miami was a new event. It was new to everyone because it was the first year of that. Actually, Miami was horrible. There was this one parking lot that they took the track to, and somebody decided to put a sealer down like probably a week before, and it was absolutely, you couldn't stand up in it.
Yeah.
And no matter what you did, every time you go through it, you'd scare yourself to death, and you come through it and go a little bit slower, and you'd still scare yourself just as badly. So it probably just became, well, we might as well go fast, because if we're going to crash, we might as well make it big. But yeah, but Cleveland, though, was the coolest track. I don't know how you felt about Cleveland. And that was the only time I ever got to race there. And it was so much fun, because it was, most tracks, the line of the track is very kind of obvious. You ride there, and within three laps, you kind of figure it out. At Cleveland, you're just given this expanse. And you could be approaching it from way over there, or you could go the shortest route, and you just had so much freedom to kind of try different things. And the Cleveland Airport, and also if you're racing somebody, you could be 100 feet on the other side of the track from them, so they'd be looking at their mirrors trying to find where you were, and not have any idea. I hope that they put it together, and it'd be great if IndyCar went back there.
Try it.
Okay, somebody back, I see a hand. Go ahead.
Was there really any advantage to cooling the fuel with dry ice?
Yeah,
sure was. The fuel would become more dense, and you could get more gallons, well, not more gallons, but more fuel energy into the car. And we did that at Indianapolis for I don't know how long. I mean, everything you do, they banned it eventually. But we used to have big saddlebags that we put on the refueling rig, and we filled those saddlebags with dry ice, and there's all kinds of stuff that we...
You get one in, and as it got burned and heated up, there was more in the tank than you could get in without pressurizing.
And Indy, the drivers particularly liked it, because as soon as you put fuel in the car got really cold.
What's the percentage? I don't know what the percentage is. It would be...
pretty small.
Yeah, be small. But that's my tip for people. Fill your car up at night. Couple percent.
And how about the mile-high fuel rate that was banned after the first race?
Well, those are such obvious things to do.
There was no rule about how high the fuel cell could be. It had to be fed by gravity. Mm-hmm. So Penske made one that was 30-some feet tall.
It's 24, I believe.
24. And I remember that from reading the book. When the fuel stopped, there was so much, I don't know what caused it, but it basically would whip the end of the fuel line and not the fuel.
What really happened? We had the fuel tank up really high, because the higher it is, the higher the pressure is, the faster the flow. But what the refueling guy would do, he had a hose, a 3-inch diameter hose, and he would jam the door on the top of the fuel cell was no longer something you had to unhook and open. It was simply a door that, as you came down with the hose, the door would just spring loaded down. The fueler would stab the nozzle into the hole. Donahue would count to four and leave. As he left, the fueler would just pull the hose out, fuel everywhere. So we put 22 gallons of fuel in about 4 seconds.
The 24-foot rig was only used one time. That was at the Michigan race in 69. They banned it right after that. It comes back to 12. But Don Lee, who used to own one of the 69 cars out in the San Francisco area, and an avid vintage racer on the West Coast, made a replica of the 24-footer right down to the paint scheme, except same tubing and everything. And he took it to a vintage race in Laguna Seca. And they didn't put fuel in it, but they put some colored water or something like that,
did it
something. And did a test into a fuel cell, and it was like 3.2 seconds, and the fuel cell was blown up. It still exists out there.
And
FCCA changed the rules for the thing to, they made a rule that after they did their cell, that the valve had to be at 6 foot off the ground. So we did a cell that was still 24 in feet in the air as far as a 50-gallon drum, but then a steel tube came down to the valve, so the valve was at 6 feet. So that would also dump fuel in 3.5 seconds, which we did in the back of our car craft parking lot. Well, in the 69 season, it sat for most of the race, but someone in their infinite wisdom decided that they're going to have this thing at one of the races on the West Coast, which I think was Kent, Washington, or one of those. So we set up that rig, and the first time it got tested in a race was at the race itself. When he put the thing into the fuel for the first time, the fuel came in so fast that there was steel balls venting on either side for the fuel tank. The flow of the fuel dropped, pushed the steel balls up and locked them so there was no vent, and all the fuel came out, needless to say, on the front of his pants, which he had to be rescued immediately, dumping water on, because you can imagine it probably burned fairly well. The balls were stuck in there so hard that we had to go in with a broom handle and try to release them.
Now, these are the balls in the tank now?
Yes. All four of them were in trouble.
Races are clever, but they're not always smart.
Go ahead.
Hi. The greatest racing I ever enjoyed was Can-Am and Trans-Am. Things are different today. With BOP and all the restrictions and tighter formulas, it's every race almost feels like a spec race. And it's not nearly as enjoyable. I wonder if anyone would care to comment, or if you ever see this changing. Ingenuity and creativity are gone.
Well, I get why it's happened, but I was telling you beforehand, what it's done is it's undermined the actual reason that racing was invented, which was to find out who the best was. And you wonder why people aren't as into it. And so, I mean, I don't know. It's because you used to be able to tell if that guy was going 50 feet deeper before he hit the brakes, you knew it was because he and his team were doing a better job of it. And now on these weekends, it's whether the BOP is tipped in your favor. I think they've got to figure something out. Again, I mean, equivalency formulas are really, really hard to do. NASCAR learned getting away from, they more or less have a standard body, which is cookie cutter a little bit, but the teams are allowed to work hard and come up with their own. They got to keep putting them back in their box a little bit, but they're allowed to innovate. I joke that Lemons Racing, the $500 shitboxes, pardon my French, is the most innovation in racing right now, because everybody goes to one of those races, and I talk, and they come back, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to get a so-and-so Celica, and I'm going to cut all the fenders off to save weight, and so it's all the... They've got to figure out a way to get some of the creativity and innovation back. I agree. It's not a simple answer, but the market is never wrong. And if everybody loses interest, they'll get serious again about bringing some of that back. I'm not sure what the answer is, but I think this is not it. Anybody else?
It really is a real problem, because I have not talked to Roger Pinsky about this lately, but I know how he thinks, and to get into a racing series and know that if you go a tenth of a second quicker than the next guy, they're going to add weight to your car for the next race. If you get, three more horsepower than somebody else, they're going to do something to you. And it just, I don't know where it all ends up. And I'm sure a guy like, not that he's ever said this to me, but a guy like Roger is like, why am I going to get involved in that series? Because as soon as you even win a race, they penalize you. It's a problem.
I'd be curious what you gentlemen think, if they agree at all. I think one of the things that's happened is the tires are so good now, especially when they came into radial tires. And now when you watch the cars, they're not really that dramatic, because, I mean, they're going really fast, but you don't see any movement in the car. Where you look back at when the bi-fly, the cross-fly tires
move, you can see the cars moving around.
Exactly, it's exciting, yeah. And, you know, when the radials came along, it was important for Goodyear and everyone to make radial race tires now to show what, you know, what they can do. But I think we're past the point where anyone, you know, believes that the race tires really relate to the street tires. So I think they should just go back to cross-ply tires. And make them intentionally with big slip angles.
So the car don't
want
to drive?
Well, no, I'm retired now, so I can say that. and that would also, I think, help with a lot of the like Formula One and such. If you had a car, to get a lap time, if you had to have the car sideways a lot, that would reduce a lot of the aerodynamic. Yeah, you'd have to have a car that was good in the yaw.
So that's the engineer to tell us why that would or wouldn't be right.
No, I'm going to say, while you're doing your rule, you need to have 8-inch rims with 12-inch tires.
Right.
So these guys, Chuck and his company, had to take a body grinder to the leaf spring in the back so the tire would clear the spring, essentially. And every time, no matter how far they ground it away, they'd come back and there'd be tire marks, essentially, on the spring.
It's also interesting to just sort of think how where the modern tire came from. Don't forget, in Indianapolis, as late as I don't know what years it would have been, probably somewhere along in the 60s, there was one guy that had a car with some really wide tires, but I think Mickey Thompson. But really, along about that same time, I was doing test work at Jim Hall's racetrack in Midland, Texas, with a tire test machine where we had this machine that we could put tires in. We could put different rim widths. We could have different weights on the tires. We could measure the slip angles. We could change the camber. We could do all kinds of things. And I would spend hours on this. And one day, the apparatus I had, it typically was, you know, 6 inches, 8 inches wide tires. And so I had room, so I put two tires in there side by side. And all at once, it's a whole new era. And that I don't know, but I think that may have been the start of wide tires. And now, maybe other people were working at the same time, maybe Firestone was, maybe Goodyear was. But I remember distinctly going to Goodyear and asking them to make a 12-inch wide tire. And they're like, why do you want that? And that was the beginning of what we're facing with today. So we went back to narrower tires. It would end up with more exciting races.
I think today, correct me if I'm wrong, tires are pretty much spec tires. You can only get. Back then, I think they were able to contact Goodyear or Firestone and say, hey, build me a tire. And it was very competitive, very secretive about the tire situation.
There is a spec tire in most series, but like in GTLM now, there is no spec tire. Michelin has run almost everybody off, but Dunlop is like over in Europe, Dunlop, there is a tire war. Wherever there's a tire war, that stuff still happens.
Really? So yeah, they can still go and get special treatment. I know Michelin does. I've heard that.
What you have is when you get one group that is so good that they take off, they don't leave crumbs for anyone else, eventually people leave. So that's actually why some of these rules for equalizing, you know, everybody needs to get a trophy. So they you know, there's, I get why it comes, but it also, you know, if you're not careful, it undermines the whole point.
But back in the day, I do remember the tire wars and the secrecy of the tires that Penske had. I remember, and Chuck was part of this story, Peter Gregg showed up in the series, and he had this young guy who was hanging out with him, ended up being Hurley Haywood, and we didn't know Hurley at the time, but we watched. I said, I saw Hurley standing at the Penske pits, and he's marking down the numbers of the tires, and I saw him doing that, and I said to Chuck, I said, hey, and he said, okay, let's follow him. So we followed Hurley, and we see he's heading towards the Bruno's pit, and there's Peter facing us, and he's laughing, and he says, Hurley, they're following you. So we had to see where exactly this information was going. But it was very competitive at the time.
During the IndyCar tire war, Firestone would make, they'd have to dismount, they wouldn't let a team take a tire home with them. because, you know, like Roger would steal people, you know, if someone was getting ready to go, Roger would never leave Goodyear because he was the distributor, but if someone, you wouldn't let them have a tire, so they would have to, the teams have to get all their, and they would have a certain set of maybe obsolete ones that they could align the car on, roll it, and so forth, but they were so worried about the technology, both the construction and the compound in the tires, they didn't want them getting out of there.
Questions? Okay.
There's one more.
I'd just like to make a comment. Two things, actually, that I think TA2 currently has gone back to bias ply tires.
Correct.
Just for the reasons you guys are talking about. And it is great to watch the slip angles on those cars, which you just don't see today. But I'd also like if Butch and Tommy, you guys both drove prototypes and Trans Am cars about the same time. Could you comment on the transition between the two? I mean, generally, the Trans Am cars you drove were a little more higher downforce than the older cars. It's going to be quite a difference to switch.
Well, it's like anything. It's no different than an engineer that gets a new formula. You've got to basically figure out what makes it work, and that applies to the driving style as well, and that feeds into also the direction you push for with the engineers. And so, I was fortunate to drive a lot of different cars coming up, and so I didn't. So the danger is if you only drive one thing, your style evolves into a very narrow range, and you don't know why it is. You know it's the fastest, but if you haven't had to think about it switching back and forth, I was lucky that I drove some stock cars, I drove some open wheel, and so you had to remind yourself, you know, when you got in it, if you were driving them on the same season or even on the same weekend, you had to remember this one weighs 1,800 pounds, and that one weighs 2,600 pounds, or what have you. But generally speaking, you had to drive a high downforce car straighter. You really had to talk to yourself to get to carry, roll the speed into the corners. That's where the speed was. And so, I mean, again, it's figuring out how to unlock the potential of each one, both the tire and the, you know, the technical package.
Okay, one final question.
Butch is going to.
Never mind.
Trans Am today, you were talking previously about somebody thought you had traction control, but in the Trans Am series today, are the cars permitted to have traction?
No. They're still all H pattern, so there's no paddle shifts.
No paddle shifts.
They're no electronics allowed. Compare that to the GT3 cars that are in GTD. They have all the cars have full traction control is allowed, but the GT3 cars also have ABS, which, you know, it's good for some of the drivers with less experience.
Yeah.
But Trans Am is still all old school.
So why don't we? So when the other series, which have a paddle and ABS, my perception would be the racing would be much more interesting. And also, more drivers wash out.
And
you maybe have less accidents. You might have less control. You might have less adding weight penalty all the time because you.
Well, yeah, I think all of us would agree with that. The I think if I was in charge, and I think probably you guys as well, everything would go back to H pattern gearboxes. No traction control, no ABS, just because. You know, and there are reasons why they did it. You know, car owners love paddle shifts because there's no misshifts with exploding engines, so it gets a lot cheaper that way. But you used to actually be able to have an advantage on somebody. You know, if you were really good on the braking and the downshifting and everything, you know, you could actually have an advantage. Now, I raced the GT3 cars a couple years ago, and a dead novice, and to me, you know, having more experience, I couldn't break any later than anyone, just because everyone just goes, you know, to this number,
yeah,
and just welds their foot to the floor, yeah. And you know, so it becomes very, you know, kind of what am I doing here? And actually, the previous question, I just wanted to add on. I've driven GT cars before, Trans Am, and then prototypes. And when I got into Trans Am, actually, what I was able to get up to speed was from watching Tommy before, because I remember everyone saying you had traction control, and I'd go out and watch, and you would see that he was actually just really knew what the car was doing. But with the Trans Am cars when we raced them were fixed axle. And so in the middle of the turn, you couldn't do anything. You know, you brake really late. In the middle of the turn, you basically had to be off of everything. You know, you didn't dare touch the throttle because it would just drop the rear. And it looked cool. You know, and you'd see like a lot of people that you were racing would have the back hanging off doing Joe Villeneuve stuff. But Tommy would come off and just like be patient and wait and get the weight transferred. As soon as the weight was transferred, he was gone. And you know, so it probably looked suspicious, but it was actually just really managing the weight transfer. And so when I started doing it, I practiced that. And you know, going from a prototype where you just, you know, as soon as you see, you know, that you're going to make it through the turn, you weld your foot to the throttle. With this, you know, you really had to wait until everything was done with the turn, and then go.
And it used to infuriate me, the traction control allegations. I remember talking to Gary Nelson, he was the technical director of NASCAR, and he actually was the crew chief on the Mellow Yellow car when I drove. I said, they all say I'm cheating. And I said, it's just infuriating. They're discrediting all the work we're doing. He says, I know it pisses you off. He says, but you ought to be happy when they say that stuff. He says, because they're never actually going to figure out what you're really doing. Because it's just all the hard work and so forth. And so, you know, Dorsey, I love Dorsey to death, but he's a total cowboy. And, I mean, spectacular, fun to watch. If you didn't have a stopwatch, you're like, that guy is the fastest. And I used to think, I'm like, is it my job to teach him what's easier on the tires, what's faster, et cetera, et cetera. So, it's the way it goes. But smooth doesn't look as good, but it is faster, no question.
Everyone who's watching on the live streaming, if you're still watching, I assume.
Mom,
glad you were here. Thank you very much.
Again, thank you for this wonderful panel. Terrific job. Thank you very much for your moderator. We have refreshments for you over at the Research Center, and Judy has also brought a significant supply of posters.
Oh,
we have posters for everyone. Don't leave without getting your poster. Thanks again for coming. Let's go on over to support.
Searching far and wide, searching for answers beyond the great divide. I've been looking deep within, looking to find what's always been inside of me.